Hello again. As you know, I am Eli, the computer guy, and today I want to talk about the viability of your tech endeavor as a technology professional. This is something that people do not think enough about whenever they go out to start their project, whatever it may be. If they need to go out there and get traction, if they need to go out there and start a business, whatever it is, a lot of the times they don't really think about the viability of the business, and this can run into a lot of problems going forward. Basically, when we start thinking about viability, what I want you guys to think about is don't necessarily think of the resources, don't necessarily think of the expense, don't think of a lot of the things that you normally think about with viability. The thing that I want you to think about with viability is, are there enough people out there that are interested in your product, or are there enough people out there that are actually going to buy your product or service to make your venture actually viable? If you've got 100% of the traffic out there, would that still be enough money for you? So this came up yesterday, actually. So I was doing one of the silicon trailer things with somebody that owns a computer repair shop here in the South Dakota area. And so basically the person came and he sat down and he said, well, my number one question for you is how to boost walk-in traffic. It's like, okay, well, that's an interesting question. So this person already has a computer repair business. Again, we had our discussion about that, but you know, that's their decision. They already have a storefront. This has already been set up. And so the question is, how do they get more walk-in traffic? Now, it's important for you guys to understand, again, I try to be precise when I talk about things on these videos, because unfortunately so many people are so new that they conflate a lot of different concepts into one. So I want you guys to understand right now when I'm talking about the story, I'm simply talking about walk-by traffic. I'm not talking about other advertising. I'm not talking about AdWords advertising, I'm not talking about bulletin boards, I'm not talking about going out and putting up pull tab signs or door hangers. This is walk-by traffic. So if you're going to have a retail establishment, walk-by traffic is just an amazing thing. It is just a wonderful thing. It is basically just the equivalent of a golden goose. So if you're going to go out there and you're going to get a retail storefront, almost all the time, there are some sometimes it doesn't matter so much, but almost all the time, basically you want to get customers simply by the customers literally walking by your store and going, oh, look, a computer repair shop. You know, I need computer repair. And then they walk in and they talk with you and they do business. So again, with any business, one of the costs that you have to look at, the biggest cost, really, honestly, the biggest cost that you have to look at is something called client acquisition cost, right? Or cost per acquisition. CPA is normally the abbreviation you'll see, cost per acquisition. And so basically, how much does it cost you to get a new client? How much does it cost you to get a new user? Because if you look at what the average value of a client is, and you look at the average cost per acquisition of a client, if the cost per acquisition is significantly less than the value of the client, then you've got a good business. If the cost per acquisition is literally more, and I've seen this happen, more than your client is worth, then you're just going to lose a lot of money and then go out of business. So basically, to give you a hint, back when I had my computer repair shop, we did all kinds of advertising. I have personally paid about $160,000, $170,000 out of my pocket in advertising, so I can talk about this. We did billboards, we did magazines, we did television, we did radio, we did AdWords, we did all kinds of other stuff. And basically what I found was the best cost per acquisition price was for AdWords, and it was $85 per new client, which was awesome. Again, as it was the good old days and clients were worth a lot of money. Because literally using AdWords, it was like turning on a tap. Oh, we're not busy enough today. Okay, I'll boost our AdWords spend to $1,000 today. Oh, we've got more work than we know what to do with. Okay, I'll take the AdWords spend down to $100 for the day, right? It was really like turning on the water. So the thing is, with walk-by traffic, it's essentially more or less free traffic, because you're not paying for AdWords, you're not paying for a billboard, you're not paying for all these other things. People simply just walk by and go, oh, look, here's a store, I'm going to go in, and then you do the sales presentation. So this person says, you know, I need to really work on the, you know, the walk-by traffic. And so it's like, okay, well, that's a pretty simple thing to do. No big deal. And so, you know, I talk to him, it's like, okay, well, do you have a good sign, you know, out front? And he said, I think it's a four or 4 foot by like 8 foot, like computer repair sign. It's like, okay, you've got a four, you got a computer repair sign. And it's like, yeah, but can people really see that you're there? And he said on the main road, he put up all the flags and everything. And it's like, okay, well, you know, are you actually in a, are you in the town? Or are you in a shopping center? And basically said he was in a small shopping center that had people, like retailish type stuff comes in, but not really anything else. And so I'm sitting there, I'm like, okay, well, you've already got flappy sign, you know, you've already got a sign, so that's a big thing. You'd be surprised how many people don't even put up an effing sign. And then it's like, and then you have an attractant. So whenever you're going to have a retail storefront, you want what's called, it's an attractant, basically something to catch the eye. If you have a storefront and it is literally so bland that nobody looks at it, here's the thing, if nobody looks at your storefront, nobody's going to read the sign overhead. So you want some kind of attractant. So you either put like signs in the window, you put some kind of LCD screen, you put flags that flap in the wind. You know, flags, I'm not a proponent of flags, but you know, flags, you know, they're good enough. So, you know, I'm sitting there and it's like, okay, and then you're in this retail thing. So I'm like, so how are you going to get more walk-by traffic? And so I'm thinking about some things, and then I'm like, okay, well, tell me how much walk-by traffic you're getting now. Like right now, what are we looking at? You know, are we getting 10 people a day coming into the store? Are we getting 20 people a day coming into the store? Are we getting 5 people a day coming into the store? And he looked at me and said, well, I've had one paying customer in the past 2 weeks. That's walk-by traffic. He has other clients, but one person walked in the door and dropped off a computer simply by walk-by. And then I looked at him and was like, what? You had one person in 2 weeks? And then I said, well, okay, that's the person that's actually dropped off something, but you know, I'm sitting here and I'm thinking, and it's like, okay, well, maybe this guy is screwing up the sales process. So a lot of you guys do that too, where people walk into the store and they're interested in getting their computer repair, getting work done, but then you just completely flub the sales process. You know, maybe your prices are too high, maybe you don't have a nice uniform, maybe the store looks like crap. You know, there's a lot of ways you can screw up the sales thing. And so I ask, you know, okay, well, you know, how many people even come into your shop? And basically he said 3 to 5 per week. At which point I looked at him and went, oh, boy, you got a problem. You got a bigger problem than I can probably handle. And this is one of those things that you should be thinking about with your business venture is, you know, everybody wants to have this idea of, you know, if I come up with a better way to advertise, or if I put up a better sign, or if I do something, you know, I can make this work. There's that idea, I can make this work. When in reality, a lot of times, the position you're in, you simply can't make that work. You know, talking with this person, it's like one person has dropped off a computer in 2 weeks. And you only get three, I mean, he gets on average less than one person a day walking into that store. So we talked about a few things. We talked about a few things that he could do. But realistically, what that tells me is that that area isn't viable for him, right? If you have a store and literally nobody is walking in the door, or less than one person a day is even walking in the door, that's not viable. Especially, like I say, already got the sign, already got the attractant. Again, he can work on the attractants. He might be able to do a couple of other things. But if you're getting literally 0.75 clients or possible clients walking through the door a day, even if you double that, it's still only 1.5 possible. And that's not even getting to the whole sales process and whether or not you're even going to be able to sell anything. So I'm sitting there and I'm talking with him. And this is the important thing to think about, especially with any of your business venture. So we're sitting there, we're talking, you know, how long is the lease and all that kind of stuff. And then he brings up the thing. He said, well, it's, you know, however long, but I have a 1 month buyout. And looked at him and said, explain to me that 1 month buyout a little better. And he said, well, basically I pay 1 month rent and I can leave. So this is an important thing to think about for any of you guys in economically depressed areas or areas that aren't booming, is that basically, again, people who lease property, people who rent property out, are just like employers. They're just like bosses. They want to sell you the best the best lease for them possible. But if it's very difficult to rent out space, they will give very good terms for you, right? So if you go to the Baltimore area and you try to get a retail space in a shopping center, a lot of times you're going to have to sign a 5-year lease. And not only are you going to have to sign a 5-year lease, you're going to have to personally vouch for that lease, which means even if your company goes bankrupt, you're still on the line for that lease, right? So so that's one of the issues with the big cities is you get into those types of leases. You come out to South Dakota, and it's a little harder to get people into retail space. And so basically, this person has a retail space, apparently in, you know, a little shopping center with a 1-month buyout. And so I'm sitting there, and I'm looking at it, and I'm thinking about this, and it's like, you know, realistically, we put in better signs, we put in flashier things. How much better can we really make this for you, right? 0.75 possible new people come in the door per day. Again, even if we double that, even if we triple that, even if we like quadruple that or something, if we get 4 people a day, do we really think we're going to get 4 people a day at this place? And so what I told this person, something for you guys to be thinking about, is if he only has a 1-month buyout, that his best option is to leave. And if he really wants to still do the retail thing, go find a retail space that actually gets walk-by traffic, right? I mean, if walk-by traffic is your goal, then you want to make sure you're in an area where people, in fact, walk by. And this is one of the issues, too, that I see with a lot of people, is people aren't honest enough with the numbers. People aren't honest enough with the metrics. Again, talking with this person, there are a few storefronts in this particular shopping center that bring in people consistently, but talking with them, it's still not a lot of people, right? If you want to be getting work from walk-by traffic, you need hundreds of new people per day walking by. I would argue, even with a computer repair shop or something, you want at least 200 people walking. And that's not even a lot, to be frank with you. That's not even a lot. Because you just think about it. You know, if you have, you know, somebody walk by every 2 minutes, which is a pretty empty street. If you only have somebody walking by every 2 minutes, is a pretty empty street. But that's 30 people per hour. So in 5 hours, that's 150 people. In a 10-hour day, that's 300 people, right? And that's one person walking by every 2 minutes, which isn't what most people consider a busy street. Even a slow street, let's say somebody's walking by every 5 minutes, that's still, what is that, 12 people per hour over a 10-hour day, that's 120 people. And you need to have that many people, at least. You need at least 100 people walking by. I'd say 200 or 300 people walking by. Because again, you have to realize you're only going to get a very small percentage of the people that walk by. If 100 people walk by and you're able to get 1% of those, basically one person to walk through the door, you're doing pretty good, right? So one of the things to be thinking about when we're thinking about viability is that you're being honest with yourself with the numbers. So sitting there talking with this person about his retail establishment, you know, it's apparently in a shopping center, so people have to drive to it. You don't really get normal walk-by traffic. And then although the storefronts in there get a consistent flow of people, listening to him talk about it, I can't really imagine that it's more than 100 people a day that are coming into it. So if he wants walk-by traffic and there's not even 100 people a day coming into his shopping center, then you're not gonna get any walk-by traffic. Again, even if you're doing really, really, really good, if the possibility is too small, it's just not going to be viable. And so sitting there talking with this guy, especially since he has a 1-month buyout, the thing that I told him is if you really want walk-by traffic, really, go find an area that actually has people walking by. You need to have enough people walking by in order to get that walk-by traffic. And I know that sounds like you're sitting there and you're like, oh, Eli, oh, you just think you're so smart saying, ooh, you need enough people walking by. But this is one of those things that people just don't think enough about, right? You know, and that's a thing. Realize with this, again, we had a very long conversation. This is just one component when we're talking about advertising and stuff. But enough people don't think about this enough. If you want walk-by traffic, you need enough people walking by so that if you get 1% of that number, it makes your venture viable. right? If you don't have a big enough number of people walking by, then again, it doesn't matter what you do, your venture won't be viable. And so this is something that I really want you guys to think about, because it's so easy, again, you look at the wrong thing, right? I want walk-by traffic, therefore I will get a retail space. I mean, how many people do this? I've seen a lot of people do this. I want a retail computer store, so I'm going to get retail space. Well, there's 1,000 different types of retail space, right? There's retail space in small little shopping centers that nobody ever goes into. There's retail space on very busy, big, busy streets, but there's no parking. There's all kinds of retail space out there. It's not that I get retail space and I get walk-by traffic. There's different types of retail space out there, so you have to be thinking about that if you actually, in fact, want retail space. You know, again, focus on and ask yourself, what is your actual goal? And then look at what is required to accomplish your goal. And then see if what you are about to rent, if you're about to rent a retail space, actually matches that. Again, if you're thinking, I want to get a retail space in order to get walk-by traffic, are there hundreds of people walking by per day, right? You know, if I was going to open a computer repair shop again or something along those lines, right? And I was going to get a retail space nowadays, I would get a retail space in a place that has a grocery store. Why? If you have a grocery store, most likely you're going to get a lot of people coming in and out, right? You have a grocery store, you have a retail space by a grocery store, you put your computer repair attractants, you know, flapping in the wind, 1,000 people a day go to that grocery store, they look over, you get 1% of those 1,000 people, that's 10 people a day, it almost makes it worthwhile, right? You know, do something like a grocery store. Back in the day, when Blockbuster, you know, when there were movie rental places, get your thing right by a movie rental place. Maybe in the same shopping center as like a CVS or a pharmacy. Basically, if you're going to get a retail space and you want that walk-by traffic, you want to put your store in a place where a lot of people are coming for something else. So again, if you're going to be in a city, and this is an important thing, like if you're going to be in town. So some of you guys are like, well, I want to get a retail space in town. Make sure you get the retail space where people actually walk by. This is a big problem that I see, is people look and they go, okay, well, I can get a retail space on High Street or Main Street of a small town for this much money. But only one block over, Eli, only one block over, I can get twice the space for half the price. I would be stupid not to go one block over. It's like, yeah, no. Why? Because again, if you want walk-by traffic, everybody walks up and down Main Street, right? You know, if it's Main Street, that means there's normally a courthouse, there's normally stuff going on in Main Street, and therefore you actually get traffic on Main Street. You go one block over, and this is something to think about with a lot of, you know, when you're thinking about business. You go one block over, and it is surprising how many people don't walk down that street. Right? I spent a lot of time growing up in a relatively small city. And that was the interesting thing. You know, just one of those things that I picked up walking through it all the time. Because I grew up during the 80s when kids, before the age of helicopter parents, right? For my generation, we were called latchkey kids. Basically where, you know, the kids, or the parents threw the set of keys at us and we could do whatever the hell we wanted until about 6 o'clock at night, right? So I would go into the small town and take a look around, and it was like, if you go on Main Street, there was like two streets in the town. What was it? It was Main Street and High Street. So really there was these streets made a T, right? And so if you were a business on one of those streets, you had a crap ton of walk-by traffic. But the city was, or the small town was bigger than that, and there were all these other streets, and it really was a thing where if you were one block off of that main street, nobody walked by. So you saw a lot of businesses, and me, even as a kid and a teenager, I'd go in and talk business with these people, and it was so funny because people would be like, oh yeah, I was able to get this great retail space for just a fraction of the cost, as if I got a space on Main Street or High Street. And then, you know, 5 months later they would be dead because nobody walked by that street. right? So these are the types of things that you need to be thinking about, you know, viability with your business. Again, something with viability, my buddy Tony, right? So I talk about Tony a lot. I like Tony a lot. He's part of the Baltimore tech scene. But one of the things we got into a discussion a long time ago, actually, I think I wrote a whole blog post about why his original startup wouldn't work. And the reason was, is because the concept itself wasn't viable. Again, something to think about with your business. And so Tony, when I met him, he and his co-founder had started this startup company for tie swapping, you know, ties. And he started a startup company about 2 decades too late. Anyways, that's one of the things I told him. I was like, you do realize nobody really wears ties anymore. So I'm not really sure how well is tie swapping going to go when ties themselves are kind of going out of fashion. But one of the things he never really did is really sat down and thought about the viability. And so, one of the things I did, just me being me, is one time I wrote out this blog post talking about how the entire business itself wouldn't be viable. And this is something to think about. So they were talking about, so tie swapping. So the idea was you have ties, somebody else has ties, and then you would swap ties. And then they would take a small fee for you guys being able to swap ties, right? It's a whole sharing economy thing. And so one of the things I did was I laid out everything for him and said, okay, let's imagine for a second that you get 100%. You get 100% of the tie swap market out there, right? You know, and that's everything. There's actually a couple of people that were trying this whole tie swap thing. Whatever. But I said, let's say you get 100% of the market. And it's like, okay, so you get 100% of the market, and what can we imagine, optimistic? How big can we imagine this tie swap market be? And so it's like, okay, let's imagine what that is. And so we did, you know, whatever the number was, and was like, this is the most optimistic you could possibly be about how many people would actually want to swap ties. Then it was like, okay, well, how much money, how much profit do you make per tie swap? And so there's the cost for the tie swap, but then there's the gross and resources and all that, and divided it down, and then came out with it. And basically it was like, okay, if you get 100% of the market, that means then that you get 100% of the market. This is what the most your profit is going to be. You have 2 founders, which means you have to split it. And so it came out to something like, if they gained 100% optimistically of what the entire tie swap market would be, it came out to like $150,000 a year profit divided by two, because there were 2 founders, which came out to $75,000 a year, which meant if they were the Facebook of tie swapping, they would be making less money than if they just went out and got a job somewhere. And it was one of those things that you don't really think about until you sit down and you do all of the numbers. If I gain 100% of this market, how much money is it going to be? Because that's one of the things, right? You know, people aren't looking at the right thing. Again, I get a retail space, de facto, that means I get walk-by traffic, right? I become the Facebook of tie swapping, de facto, I have $1 billion. And it's like, no, Facebook has $1 billion because Facebook is imagined to be worth many billions of dollars. Even if you corner the tie swap market, there's just not that much money there, right? I remember doing the math for him, and it was like, listen, even if we double optimist, even if we do all this wacky, I can't even possibly grasp how you might be able to profit $500,000 a year off of this. And that is being beyond optimistic on every single front. And it's like, oh, yeah, maybe that's a problem. And again, something for you guys to think about, like I said, talking with Tony about this, is he really was trying to start a startup company, you know, trying to go out there and make a lot of money, create something that's exitable. And when you're sitting there and you're talking about something that even best case scenario brings in $150,000 profit, that's not exitable. And that's absolute best case scenario. The reality would be a hell of a lot less. And so this is something that I want you guys to be thinking about when you start your business venture. Again, a lot of you guys, you know, if you're in a small town, this is something to think about. Again, I would say go to a small city. I just did a video on small cities. Think about going to small cities. Because if you're in a small town, like right now when I'm here in South Dakota, I'm technically in this town called Custer, South Dakota, right? And so Custer, South Dakota has 2,000 residents. It does have a number of businesses here. I don't know, maybe 100 businesses because it is a tourist area. But one of the things to think about is you may be sitting there, like if you were somebody sitting in some place like Custer and you hear me talking about starting a web design company. So you're like, yeah, we have businesses here. I want to start a web design company. That's a great idea. Eli, I'm in this small town. We've got businesses. I'm going to start a web design company. And I'm going to charge, let's say, $1,000 a website, which isn't much. Really, but in a small town, that's probably about what you can charge. And it's like, well, you may be able to make money off of that, don't get me wrong, but it's going to be something that will help you buy a car or buy a vacation, not really a business. It's like, well, why, Eli? We've got businesses here. I can sell them websites for $1,000 a piece. That's a lot of profit for me. Why is that not, why are you down on that? It's like, well, if there's 100 businesses here total, that means the most websites you could ever sell in this particular area is 100. If you get 100% of those businesses as your clients and you charge them $1,000 a piece, that means the most you can tap this market for is $100,000. The most. And again, I mean, that helps you buy the house and that help, but that's not a sustainable business, right? That's something that, you know, and you may, don't get me wrong. I mean, it's not necessarily bad to only do something for a year or two, but realistically you would only be doing it for a year or two. And so that's one of the things to be thinking about is look at whatever you're planning to do and go, even if I get 100% of this market, what does it really matter? I remember I was in one of these startup shindigs once, right? And I had this guy come up to me, and he was so excited, and he said, I have the greatest idea in the world. This is going to be worth multi-millions dollars. And it really was. He was like bouncing off the wall. He's like, this is great. I was like, okay, well, let me hear your thing. And so this guy was a Muslim, and he's in the United States. And one of the issues that he had is that he was talking about, he went out bike riding one day, right? He went out bike riding one day and he biked like 15 miles and wound up in this suburb area, little town. And so since he was Muslim, he wanted to eat halal food. I think it was halal food. I'm not a Muslim, so, but I think it was halal food, right? And so he had this idea and he was like, yeah, Eli, you know, this is going to be awesome. I am going to corner the market for advertising people randomly out that want halal food. All right. So halal food is whatever Muslims do to make it religious or whatever. And I looked at him. I was like, okay, well, that's interesting. But again, even if you corner that market, how big is it? Oh, Eli, it's huge. And it's like, well, but is it huge, right? How many Muslims who are out there randomly wandering around and then all of a sudden need halal food? Most people who need that kind of food, you know, this dietary restriction, they know exactly where they're going. Even within a city, they know where the stores are. They know where to go. How many people just randomly need to know this? It's like, huh, well, that's a point, right? Because it's not about, and that's the thing, like with this thing, is it's not about the total number of people who eat halal food. It's a total number of people that eat halal food that don't know where to go for halal food. So it makes it really small. And then the thing I was talking to him about is like, okay, and then because he was saying he was going to do an advertising model. So basically the stores who sold halal food would be able to advertise. It was like, okay, but think about it this way. Think about this. You're going to have to individually go to all these stores who sell halal food, try to sell them this advertising package, which is going to be a complete pain in the ass. Nothing against Muslims, nothing against halal food. It is if you have to go door to door, knocking door to door to sell advertising, that's about one of the most painful ways to have a business you possibly can do. Again, knocking door to door to sell many things isn't too bad. Selling advertising for some kind of app you're going to create is going to be completely miserable. So that's the thing, is when this guy was looking at creating his product, he was looking at the total number of people in the United States who eat halal food. What he wasn't really looking at is how many of those people would actually need his product. Again, it then becomes so small, the question is for your business, is your business viable? Again, one of the issues that I run into with you guys is you guys talk about, and some of you may be looking at this and going, well, Eli, there's thousands of people out there that need halal food and don't know where to go to halal food. You were a complete bastard for crapping on his app. But the thing is that viable for your business? It's not whether or not some people in the world need this. It's not whether or not even 10,000 people or 20,000 people in the world need this, your product, right? It is there enough of them to make your product profitable enough that you can pay the mortgage and hopefully actually go on a vacation every once in a while? You know what I'm saying? If there's not enough users out there, potential clients out there to be able to do that, then it's simply not a viable venture. And therefore, again, you're in the technology field. Why the hell are you going to screw around with something that's not even viable from the get-go? And so this is what I want you guys to be thinking about with your projects, with your ventures, is are the numbers there, right? Because so many of you, a lot of people, you know, they talk about creating the next Facebook or creating the next LinkedIn or some wacky, the next Google. And if you're really going out there for a moonshot project, if you're really going out there to do something just fundamentally different that nobody understands, fine. Don't worry about viability. Who the hell knows? Nobody even understands what the hell you're doing, so it's really difficult to figure out if anybody is going to care at the end of the day. But the fact of the matter is, most of you guys, 99.999% of you guys, are basically going to do normal business. You're going to do computer repair, you're going to do app development, you're going to do this, you're going to do that. It may be newfangled, you may use new technology to do it, but basically it's an old business that you're doing, right? And so if you don't think about, again, even if you're optimistic, even if you corner the entire market, if you get 100% of the market, ask yourself what that means, right? Right? Be optimistic. Drink a beer. Talk about how you're going to take over the market and say, yeah, man, if I get 100% of the market and this is my profit per client and this is how much money I'm going to make. And then look at that number and then go, oh, crap. You mean so if I get 100% of the market and I'm really optimistic about my profit margin, I'm going to make $50,000 a year. and that's being like optimistic. That's not being pragmatic. That's not being like Eli pragmatic. That's being like the most optimistic possible. That number sucked. Yeah, maybe I won't worry about that anymore. So that is something to think about out there with viability, because a lot of you guys don't do it. Again, imagine if you got 100% of the market. Seriously, imagine if you got 100% of the market. What does that mean? And then if you get 100%, if you do the math and 100%, your most optimistic possibility still isn't a very pretty number, then why are you doing it? And again, the thing to think about too is if you see that a project isn't going to be viable, if you see a business isn't going to be viable, kill it as quickly as possible. Again, talking with this person, you know, with Walk By Traffic, he got one new client in 2 weeks, gets 0.75 people walking in the door per day. Kill it now. Why waste time? Again, you have opportunity costs, you have rent costs, you have all of these other costs. If you really want Walk By Traffic, kill it now. Find a storefront that actually has people walking by it and then go into there, right? Again, that's one of the issues a lot of people one of the issues with a lot of people is that they don't give up enough, right? It's okay to give up on an idea. You know, you go in, you have a certain hypothesis, you think things are going to be a certain way, and then you find out that it's not, right? It's simply not how it is, right? There's not enough walk by people. There's not enough people walking by to get walk by traffic, right? But at that point, too many people kind of just buckle down, as they say. They just, no, I'm not going to accept it. I'm just going to stay here and I'm going to buckle down and I'm going to just do this. And it's like, well, all that's going to do is waste the rest of your time on the lease. All that's going to do is waste the rest of the rent money you're paying on the lease. All that time, all of that money could be spent on some place where you're much more likely to be successful. Again, successful people in life know when to call it a day. Successful people in life know when to quit. Seriously, not lying. You do not know how many people I have known that have been multimillionaires that are no longer multimillionaires. The reason they're no longer multimillionaires is they didn't know when the F to call it a day. They didn't know when to cash out. And that is a huge issue, right? Things start going downhill, things start going badly, hypothesis isn't working how you thought it was gonna work. Can you just cut your losses and call it a day, or are you gonna just take the ride down, right? So, something to think about there, something to think about. Again, as I say, imagine you got 100% of the market. 100%! You are the best in the world. Doesn't matter. So with that, I'm going to go off, go have a little food down here in the small town of Custer, South Dakota. I do have to say, I really like the Black Hills of South Dakota. If you've not been here to the Black Hills of South Dakota, is a really cool place. My wife and I have been exploring Custer State Park over the past few days, and it's really cool because they have like lots of little critters running around. They have sheep, and they have goats, and they have deer, but they also have bison. And there is nothing quite like being about 50 feet away from just a herd of bison just sitting there in front of you. It is just a really, really, really cool experience. When you come out west here, like when you come here to this area, or you go to like Yellowstone, it's really cool because like these huge, just beasts, these massive, massive animals are just wandering around. And it's really just like an amazing experience to be able to see that. Today, my wife and I were walking through Wind Cave National Park, something like Wind Cavern National Park. But there's a cavern that you go through, but then on top it's all plains. And it was so cool because we were walking along and we went out a long ways and we looked at the mountains and we looked at the streams and all that. And then when we're walking out, we didn't see any bison, we didn't see anything. And then as we're coming back, then to our right is just like this random bison just kind of giving us the eyeball. And again, probably like only about 200 feet away, it's just sitting there munching, just this huge beast. Sitting there munching, looking at us. We looked at it, it looked at us. It's just a really, really cool experience out here. So if you've not been to the Black Hills of South Dakota, definitely come here. And again, I guess Custer State Park is like one of the largest state parks in the country. And it's really, really, it's a really nice park. It's literally like one of the best parks I've ever been to, national, state, national, otherwise. So if you get the opportunity, definitely come out here. I like South Dakota. I'm not sure I would start a business in South Dakota, but coming out here for a visit, it's definitely a nice place.
Oh, it's right at the screen door. Eli, look. Did you see that? Yeah. He went right to the screen door. It's good to shoot down the back here.
Yeah, you see the one with the bloody wound over there? She got her. She's trying to look at it and get it better.
Hmm.